Penguin Audio presents We Are All Completely Beside Ourselves by Karen Joy Fowler. Read by Orlagh Cassidy. In memory of the wonderful Wendy Weil, champion of books, animals, and in both categories, me. Your experience as apes, gentlemen, to the extent that you have something of that sort behind you, cannot be more distant from you than mine is from me. But it tickles at the heels of everyone who walks here on Earth, the small chimpanzee, as well as the great Achilles. Franz Kafka, A Report for an Academy. Prologue. Those who know me now will be surprised to learn that I was a great talker as a child. We have a home movie taken when I was 2 years old, the old-fashioned kind with no soundtrack. And by now the colors have bled out, a white sky, my red sneakers a ghostly pink, but you can still see how much I used to talk. I'm doing a bit of landscaping, picking up one stone at a time from our gravel driveway, carrying it to a large tin washtub, dropping it in, and going back for the next. I'm working hard, but showily. I widen my eyes like a silent film star. I hold up a clear piece of quartz to be admired, put it in my mouth, stuff it into one cheek. My mother appears and removes it. She steps back then, out of the frame. But I'm speaking emphatically now. You can see this in my gestures. And she returns, drops the stone into the tub. The whole thing lasts about 5 minutes, and I never stop talking. A few years later, Mom read us that old fairy tale in which one sister, the older, speaks in toads and snakes, and the other, the younger, in flowers and jewels. And this is the image it conjured for me, this scene from this movie, where my mother puts her hand into my mouth and pulls out a diamond. I was tow-headed back then, prettier as a child than I've turned out, and dolled up for the camera. My flyaway bangs are pasted down with water and held on one side by a rhinestone barrette, shaped like a bow. Whenever I turn my head, the barrette blinks in the sunlight. My little hand sweeps over my tub of rocks. All this, I could be saying, all this will be yours someday. Or something else entirely. The point of the movie isn't the words themselves. What my parents valued was their extravagant abundance, their inexhaustible flow. Still, there were occasions on which I had to be stopped. When you think of two things to say, pick your favorite and only say that, my mother suggested once, as a tip to polite social behavior, and the rule was later modified to 1 in 3. My father would come to my bedroom door each night to wish me happy dreams, and I would speak without taking a breath, trying desperately to keep him in my room with only my voice. I would see his hand on the doorknob, the door beginning to swing shut. I have something to say, I'd tell him, and the door would stop midway. Start in the middle, then, he'd answer. A shadow with the hall light behind him, and tired in the evenings the way grown-ups are. The light would reflect in my bedroom window like a star you could wish on. Skip the beginning. Start in the middle. Part 1. The storm which blew me out of my past eased off. Franz Kafka, A Report for an Academy. 1. So the middle of my story comes in the winter of 1996. By then, we'd long since dwindled to the family that old home movie foreshadowed. Me, my mother, and unseen but evident behind the camera, my father. In 1996, 10 years had passed since I'd last seen my brother, 17 since my sister disappeared. The middle of my story is all about their absence, though if I hadn't told you that, you might not have known. By 1996, whole days went by in which I hardly thought of either one. 1996. Leap year. Year of the fire rat. President Clinton had just been reelected. This would all end in tears. Kabul had fallen to the Taliban. The siege of Sarajevo had ended. Charles had recently divorced Diana. Hale-bopp came swinging into our sky. Claims of a Saturn-like object in the comet's wake first surfaced that November. Dolly, the cloned sheep, and Deep Blue, the chess-playing computer program, were superstars. There was evidence of life on Mars. The Saturn-like object in Hale-bopp's tail was maybe an alien spaceship. In May of 97, 39 people would kill themselves as a prerequisite to climbing aboard. Against this backdrop, how ordinary I look. In 1996, I was 22 years old, meandering through my fifth year at the University of California, Davis, and still maybe only a junior or maybe a senior, but so thoroughly uninterested in the niceties of units or requirements or degrees that I wouldn't be graduating anytime soon. My education, my father liked to point out, was wider than it was deep. He said this often. But I saw no reason to hurry. I'd no particular ambitions beyond being either widely admired or stealthily influential. I was torn between the two. It hardly mattered, as no major seemed to lead reliably to either. My parents, who were still paying my expenses, found me aggravating. My mother was often aggravated those days. It was something new for her, analeptic doses of righteous aggravation. She was rejuvenated by it. She'd recently announced that she was through being a translator and go-between for me and my father. He and I had hardly spoken since. I don't remember minding. My father was himself a college professor and a pedant to the bone. Every exchange contained a lesson, like the pit in a cherry. To this day, the Socratic method makes me want to bite someone. Autumn came suddenly that year, like a door opening. One morning I was bicycling to class when a large flock of Canada geese passed overhead. I couldn't see them, or much of anything else, but I heard the jazzy honking above me. There was a tule fog off the fields, and I was wrapped inside it, pedaling through clouds. Tule fogs are not like other fogs. Not spotty or drifting, but fixed and substantial. Probably anyone would have felt the risk of moving quickly through an unseen world, but I have, or had as a child, a particular penchant for slapstick and mishap, so I took the full thrill from it. I felt polished by the wet air, and maybe just a little migratory myself, just a little wild. This meant I might flirt a bit in the library if I sat next to anyone flirtable, or I might daydream in class. I often felt wild back then. I enjoyed the feeling, but nothing had ever come of it. At lunchtime, I grabbed something, probably grilled cheese. Let's say it was grilled cheese, in the school cafeteria. I was in the habit of leaving my books on the chair next to me, where they could be quickly moved if someone interesting came by, but would discourage the uninteresting. At 22, I had the callowest possible definition of interesting, and, by the measure of my own calipers, was far from interesting myself. A couple was sitting at a table near me, and the girl's voice gradually rose to the point where I was forced to pay attention. "You want some fucking space?" she said. She was wearing a short blue t-shirt and a necklace with a glass pendant of an angelfish. Long dark hair fell in a messy braid down her back. She stood and cleared the table with one motion of her arm. She had beautiful biceps. I remember wishing I had arms like hers. Dishes fell to the floor and shattered. Ketchup and cola spilled and mixed in the breakage. There must have been music in the background, because there's always music in the background now. Our whole lives soundtracked, and most of it too ironic to be random, I'm just saying. But honestly, I don't remember. Maybe there was only a sweet silence and the spit of grease on the grill. "How's that?" the girl asked. "Don't tell me to be quiet. I'm just making more space for you." She pushed the table itself over, swung it to one side, dropped it. "Better?" She raised her voice. Can everyone please leave the room so my boyfriend has more space? He needs a fucking lot of space. She slammed her chair down onto the pile of ketchup and dishes. More sounds of breakage and a sudden waft of coffee. The rest of us were frozen. Forks halfway to our mouth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.